was a bitch, your hormones probably switch inside your DNA. Problem is, all that sucker shit inside your DNA. Daddy probably snitch, heritage inside your DNA. Backbone don't exist, born inside a jellyfish, I gauge. See my pedigree, most definitely don't tolerate the front. Shit I've been through probably offend you, this is Parler's oldest son. I know murder, conviction, burners, boosters, burglars, ballers, dead, redemption, scholars, fathers, dead, with kids and I wish I was fed. Forgiveness, yeah. Soldier's DNA, born inside the beast. My expertise checked out in second grade. When I was 9, on sale motel, we didn't have nowhere to stay. At 29, I've done so well, hit cartwheel in my estate. And I'm gon' shine like I'm supposed to. Antisocial extrovert, and exit lit mean an extra work. And absentness, what the f*** you hurt? And passiveness never struck my nerve. And that's a riff gonna be this case. The reason my power's...
Hey, this is Colin from Grayscale. You're listening to Blaze Radio.
This is Oprah. And you're listening to Blaze Radio, broadcasted at the Bill Austin Studio. You get Blaze Radio. You get Blaze Radio. Everybody gets Blaze Radio.
Everybody gets Blaze Radio, said Oprah once. Welcome, everybody, inside the Bill Austin Radio Studio. My name is Zach Bradshaw, alongside Mattie Freeze. We are here for your favorite Tuesday traffic jam. Last week, Mattie was not here. How does it feel to be back in the studio, Mattie?
So good to be back.
Yeah?
Yes.
You're exciting?
I missed it.
It's very homey in here, I would say.
It is. I came back over the weekend to do my little specialty show, and I was like, oh, the studio.
I was, like,
gone for a week, and I was, like, so happy to be back.
It's just cozy. Yes. I don't know. They just put little lights in here, and they put some, like...
I know. The orange lights are very...
It's a good addition.
The ambiance.
The good ambiance, exactly.
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely.
I feel like sometimes you'll be in like the Cronkite, like the studios upstairs where it's like the filming studios, you mm-hmm. know. And it doesn't feel like too like comfortable, you know, because it's like all like metal. But in here, you come in here, they have like carpet. It's very nice.
Yeah. I like to hang out in the what are they called?
On the edit bays, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. I do like homework in the edit bays all the time.
Computers, it's so quiet, it's just peaceful.
Yes. I just like to be close to Blaze.
Again, good ambiance. Like, you're totally right there. We got a lot of news to get to, and biggest news, Mattie. Oh my gosh.
What
the
could
Oscars.
It be? Oh.
Yeah, you would never guess, right?
What are you talking about?
That's so weird. Yeah, just crazy that the Oscars were this Tuesday.
Man.
I heard you did pretty good on your Oscar prediction sheet.
I did. I only got 3 wrong.
That's impressive.
I was pretty proud of that. But if my friends ask, it absolutely was not a competition. I just happened to win.
Yeah, I think I had a total of 3 correct. So,
oh, yeah,
a little bit opposite you.
You know, it's fine.
We're all doing our thing.
Yeah, absolutely. You picked with your heart.
Exactly.
Did extensive research. It's fine.
Exactly. Yeah, I saw the names and I was like, Belfast sounds good, right? Like.
As you should.
I don't know. I think it was a good Oscars, though. I think they were dealing with a lot of different, like, kind of variables. There's war going on. Mm-hmm. There's, you know, the end of a pandemic. You know, last year's Oscars literally sucked and had, like, the lowest ratings ever.
Yeah.
And so, like, I feel like there was a lot of different, like, challenges they were navigating in this year's Oscars.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like they kind of did it really nicely. I feel like, and I also feel like the trio of Amy Schumer and Wanda Sykes and Regina Hall, I think they were good.
Like, you liked them?
I did. I thought they were funny.
Oh, wow. I did not.
You didn't like them?
I don't like Amy Schumer.
Oh, okay. That's why.
Then... I don't think she's funny.
What
I'm
a bird.
Sorry. I think Wanda Sykes is funny. I just think the Oscars are always cheesy.
Yeah.
Like, as far as hosts go. So,
that's
I mean,
true.
I think they did fine.
Yeah.
A lot of the jokes didn't land. Like, my favorite joke that did not land at all was actually when Amy Schumer was talking about the seat fillers, and she made this joke about, she like pulled Kirsten Dunst out of her seat and was like, oh, like, thank you for doing your job as a seat filler, like, you can go away now. And her husband, and I cannot think of his name, all of a sudden it left my brain, but he's an actor too. They were in The Power of the Dog together. He was like, that is my wife. And Amy Schumer was like, what are you talking about? You're married to that seat filler. And it was a funny joke, but it just did not land. Like, the room was silent.
What?
Like, it would have been so much better
yeah.
if she had done that joke on somebody who was like so incredibly famous.
Literally.
Kirsten Dunst is famous.
But not
enough. But, like, not, like, Will Smith-level famous, you know? Or, like, Denzel Washington-level famous.
That's true.
And so if she had done it to, like, one of those people,
it could have gone
better. It would have been way funnier and way more obvious that it was a joke.
Literally.
But it was just, like, it fell so flat. And
that's
a
really good point, though.
Man. Because it was a good joke. Just... delivery was not there.
Her also, one of her jokes was along the lines of, like, you know why the Oscars hired us three, right?
Oh,
she was like,
that was my favorite joke.
Because it's cheaper than one man.
Yes, that was the best one of the night. That one was actually funny.
That one was really funny. And yet again, that one also didn't land. I was like, what the heck?
No, seriously.
That was
I love
so
that joke.
Funny.
Also, I think Amy Schumer's, I will say, I don't love her, but I think her bringing us back from after the Will Smith event.
Yeah.
When she was like, I was busy getting out of my Spider-Man costume. Like, what happened? Like, she did a good job on, like, bringing us back.
Yeah,
I
think so, too. That was a tough job.
Because I think nobody really knew what to do after that.
Of course. I think overall they did pretty good, but...
Yeah.
Enlightening moments, too, though. Troy Kotsur, the first deaf actor to ever win. That was inspirational.
That speech was incredible.
So good. And then so was Ariana DuBose's.
Mm-hmm.
She was the first openly queer African-American woman to win. So inspiring.
Yeah. And I think the other really cool thing to note about Troy Kotsur is he's from Mesa. Like, he's from here.
This is so cool.
He grew up in Mesa, Arizona. His dad was the police chief of Mesa.
It's
and
crazy.
Like, had to eventually quit because he got paralyzed. But, like, he's from here, and so that was just really... He even mentions Mesa, like, in
literally.
His speech. So it was very cool to see.
Gosh, that was pretty cool, though.
Yeah.
I don't know. Him and Ariana just... They took the stage, and, like, they did their thing.
Making history.
It was really inspiring, honestly.
Yes.
Let's talk about what was not inspiring. This Will Smith, Chris Rock...
Oh, man.
...dilemma. Oh, God. I've never seen anything like this on national television.
It was insane. I think... The joke was in bad taste, but I think Will Smith's response was absolutely unwarranted. It was way too far, way too dramatic. And I mean, I think everybody, like all of my friends were talking about, like, he took so long to, like, walk up there. Like, there was so much anticipation. And I was like, he's trying to talk himself out of it, but, like, he's already committed. Like, he has to go up there now. It was so awkward. We were watching on, like, a streaming service, so we went back and watched it, like, four times in a row because we were like, what just happened?
Yeah. And most streaming services didn't even it just like the audio just muted itself. Like,
yeah, it
for, like,
did
a
on
minute.
Like all American TV because there's
up.
A 3 minute or not 3 minute, a 3 second delay so that in case something like that happens.
Yeah.
But they don't do that in, like, Australia.
So they got the real, like, footage.
Oh my God. Which is how we have the real footage, which is so crazy.
Yeah, I think you're totally right, though. The joke was definitely in bad taste. Like, you don't make fun of a disease. Like, you wouldn't make fun of someone for having cancer. Like,
exactly.
So, like, it's very poor taste, like you said. But the reaction to it
was insane.
Not only to walk up there and, like, actually slap him, but also to continue to yell
the
at him.
Screaming.
So inappropriate, so, like, childish it felt like. And for Will Smith, he's one of the most, like, renowned, like, respected, revered actors in American history. And for him to just go up there and do that on national television, I was like, what?
It was crazy. And then I think Will Smith winning Best Actor, I think he absolutely deserved it.
Yeah, he deserved it.
For his performance in King Richard. And I think he actually gave one of my favorite Best Actor speeches I've seen in a long time.
Yeah, it was really good.
Even, like, I think he addressed what had just happened pretty well.
Yeah.
I would have liked to see more of an apology in that moment, but I feel like he couldn't backtrack.
He didn't even mention Chris Rock at all.
Yeah. So
it just felt like it was overshadowed by what he just did, and it really detracted from it in that way.
What did you think about some of their performances of the night?
I thought Beyoncé was so good. Beyoncé was at the very beginning of the night. I thought her performance was...
I didn't see it.
Oh, you didn't see it? Okay.
I didn't see it.
Her performance was really... Beyoncé performed. She was really good. Okay. The Megan Thee Stallion performance...
Please.
Of We Don't Talk About Bruno was
so... Don't get me
started
on that.
I was like,
so strange, and I did not enjoy it.
If we don't talk about a kid's song, we don't talk about Bruno, and then Megan comes in and tries this. I was like, what? Her style did not match that.
Yeah. I definitely think the other Encanto song that was performed, Dos, I'm going to butcher it because I'm so white, yeah, and I really apologize. It's Dos Orguitas?
Dos Orguitas. Yeah, I think something like that. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It means two caterpillars. That's all I know.
Yeah.
I thought that was an incredible performance. Really, it was so beautiful. And yeah.
Yeah.
And I loved that one.
You mentioned earlier that you wanted West Side Story. I agree. They yes! should have had a West Side Story performance at the Oscars.
Yeah. It was such a missed opportunity. I think they could have had this, like, wonderfully beautiful, like, dance number down the aisles.
Yeah.
Like, what they tried to do with We Don't Talk About Bruno.
Yes.
Could have been a West Side Story moment.
It could have been so much better. Steven Spielberg, also one of the most, like, revered directors of all time.
Mm-hmm.
You would think that they would, like, the one time he makes, like, a play, you know, they would, like, it was just so good. You think they would just, like,
and
totally,
I mean, also just, like,
go with that.
Coming out of Sondheim just dying. And, yeah, like, it would have been a beautiful moment to honor him.
To honor him.
Yeah.
There's,
I think it was a missed opportunity, in my opinion.
No, you're totally right. I felt that kind of odd. I thought their little joke about the Don't Say Gay thing, the Florida bill, I think that was kind of funny.
Yeah. It was an expected joke.
Yeah.
From
yeah.
the Oscars. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the little tribute to Ukraine was pretty good. I think it should have been a little longer, but
I feel like there were things that were, like, tribute to Ukraine that I was like, oh, that's good. Like, you did good. And then there were things like Jamie Lee Curtis wearing a ribbon on her finger.
Yeah.
I was like, what is that?
Like, what is that? Yeah.
What are you doing? Like,
no,
she
totally
was, like,
right.
on the red carpet, like, showing it off. Like, she was a pageant queen. And I was like, girl, put that away.
That's so true.
Like,
that
was weird. It was too much. I was like, can you calm down?
Speaking of red carpet, Serena Williams, Venus Williams, and Timothy Chalamet all showed out on the red carpet.
Oh, please.
Their outfits were immaculate.
I think my favorite outfit, though, was Lily James.
Lily
James looked incredible in that pink dress. And her hair, and she, oh, please. She was the best look of the night. I will stand by that to the ends of the earth. Timothy Chalamet looked good.
Oh, you're right.
He was serving, like, Harry Styles to me.
Yeah. That's a good look. You're absolutely right.
But Lily James was the best look of the night. I also loved Zendaya's look. She looked...
Zendaya was good.
I actually think Zendaya's after-party look was better. She had on this, like, suit-looking thing,
okay.
and it was, like... It was gorgeous.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That's good. I think... I was surprised. Andrew Garfield, for being nominated for, like, Best Actor, I was surprised he went out with such, like a minimalist look. Like, he was just wearing, like...
He looked good to me.
It looked good.
It was a good color. Because it wasn't, like, solid black, which I liked. It was... I don't know. The one thing I... Like, my one critique of his look for the night was actually that he didn't change. Like,
yeah.
Everybody changes for the after party, and he didn't.
He didn't.
And so that kind of bothered me a little bit.
Interesting point.
But I can never speak ill of Andrew Garfield. I love him so, so much.
So amazing, yeah.
So.
Yeah. I think it was a pretty good lineup of movies. A little weak this year, but overall, I think it was a good Oscar. With what they were navigating, I think it was pretty good.
Yeah.
Sadly, though, this was the second least watched Oscars of all time.
Which is so crazy.
Last year's. Last year got 9.25 million viewers. This year was 16.6, which is, in retrospect, it's a 56% increase from last year, which is good. But
yeah.
Also, second lowest of all time? That's insane.
Yeah.
I'm
actually really surprised by that.
Yeah.
But I don't know.
What's crazy to note is that viewership went up 555,000 after the Will Smith slap. So
yeah.
For those fake conspirators out there who think the slap was fake, you know, it would make sense for the Oscars to do that because they did get a lot more
increased
viewership for that.
Yeah.
And then Queen of Basketball, I thought that was really amazing how they
that moment in their acceptance speech about
Brittany Griner. Yeah.
Calling
I really
Biden
like that.
To bring her home. I thought was a good moment too.
I really liked that. Well, that was a lot of Oscars talk.
It sure was.
Why don't we just have a show on the Oscars, I feel like.
I think we should, actually.
Like, just a whole show on the Oscars. Mm-hmm. Like, that would so work.
I think you and I, just every year from now, should cover the Oscars for 100% Blaze.
For Blaze Radio. I think that would be so fun.
They should send us to...
To LA. Yeah.
To
the red carpet to take pictures and stuff. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm feeling this. I like this idea.
I'm glad we're on the same page about this.
Let's move on to a little bit of a local story. A Phoenix tennis player has alleges in a lawsuit that a U.S. Tennis Association coach has sexually abused her when she was 19. The tennis player Kylie McKenzie alleges coach Annabelle Aranda that she groped her in a 2018 practice at the USTA, that's the U.S. Tennis Association Training Center in Orlando. And so they're claiming that the Tennis Association created a culture that, quote, emboldened predator coaches, and that the organization knew about Aranda's history of sexually abusing women, but did nothing to stop it. So, a little bit of local news, and...
More local news. A Maricopa County food pantry had a fire Monday morning just after they closed. The fire started just 15 minutes after they closed, and it destroyed around 50,000 pounds of food. Smoke was still coming from the rubble 24 hours later. This is a quote, it had to be 40 to 50 feet in the air, just pure black smoke. It engulfed the entire neighborhood. That's a quote from the food pantry president, Mike Connolly. He also said the heat, we could feel down at the corner. The fire came really, really close to the Mountain View Community Church, where Connolly and CEO, Jim Schoaf, our elders, and where they feed the community.
Yeah, that's really sad. In national news, I shouldn't say that's really sad. I said that kind of upbeat. I'm sorry. Very sad news there.
Yes.
Sorry. Really sad news. A lot of food going to waste. I heard that a couple of organizations are donating back to the church now to kind of like replenish that supplies. So that's good. In national news, President Joe Biden signed a bill into law today that made lynching a federal hate crime. I'm actually surprised this wasn't already a hate crime, but now it is federally a hate crime, acknowledging that racial violence has left a lasting scar in the nation and asserting that those crimes are not a relic of the bygone era. And then one last national news story.
Job openings hovered... job openings hovered at a near record level in February. Little changed from the previous month, continuing a trend that the Federal Reserve officials see as a driver of inflation. There were 11.3 million available jobs last month, matching January's figure, and just below December's record of 11.4 million, according to the Labor Department. In a statement from Tuesday, the number of Americans quitting their jobs was also historically high at 4.4 million, up from 4.3 million in January. More than 4.5 million people quit in November, the most on records dating back two decades. Many people are taking advantage of numerous opportunities to switch jobs, often for a higher pay. The vast majority of those quitting do so to take another position. Tuesday's report is separate from the government's monthly employment report, which in February showed that employers added a robust 678,000 jobs. The data, quote, shows that the labor market remains torrid, according to Stephen Stanley, chief economist at Amherst Pierpoint. He also said in a month when the economy added 678,000 jobs, the number of job openings only went down by 17,000. That speaks to the depth of the bid that employers have for labor.
Yeah, this is kind of unbelievable. I mean, and it makes sense, though. We're coming out of a pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously a lot of jobs were lost then. But again, record level lows of job openings. It's like, and like you just said, There's jobs like that pay higher, and so people are leaving jobs like, you know, store clerks, fast food restaurants, to go after these higher paying jobs. But then, as the chain goes, it's like the pyramid. There's no left at the bottom, and then it's like,
yeah.
So then that leads, like you said, to more inflation because these other jobs that cannot be filled, they can no longer afford to even pay, even they struggle paying even the minimum wage, like, salary. And that's why, you know, store clerks, fast food employees, restaurant employees get paid so low.
Yeah.
And so it's a problem in this nation. It's really, really bad. And I've been trying so hard to think of ways for it to be fixed in any way possible, but it's just so hard with inflation rates at the way they are right now.
I think, like, there's a lot of talk from Democrats about raising minimum wage, which would bring more people wanting to work minimum wage jobs. But then you have the, like, counter to that, which is price hikes. And then, like, it's just a big roundabout. And so, right. It's for people smarter than me to figure out, luckily. But yeah, it's definitely concerning.
And
something to look at, especially as, like, people like us were about to be entering the job market.
I know.
In just a couple of years. So
it's kind of scary in a way.
Kind of scary.
As Adam Smith once said, the economist's job is not an easy one. A little bit on to the Little More National News. The CDC said the BA.2 new strand of COVID-19 caused between 51% and 59% of all new COVID-19 infections in the U.S. last week, up from the estimated 39% of all infections the week before. So they're kind of increasing the infection rate, and it's peaking with the BA.2 strand. So that's a little bit of not exactly, I don't know about startling, but it's something to keep an eye on for sure.
Yeah. As many people know, beloved Betty White died back in December. And just some tidbit news here. Betty White's beach house in California, in Camel, California, has just hit the market for about $8 million. It's a 4-bedroom house. I was looking at pictures before the show, and it's, like, gorgeous.
It is.
Yes. I was like, I wish I had $8 million.
By the old Betty White house.
Yeah. But sad, but, you know. Something interesting.
It sounds weird saying Betty White House. It sounds like I'm saying White House, but of Betty.
But
I don't know.
Betty's
but
White House.
Rest in peace, Betty White. We love you.
Ugh.
A little bit of sports news, and then we'll go on to some other Grammy news. But a little bit of sports news from 64 to just 4. The men's and women's March Madness tournaments are winding down to the final weekend of college basketball. On the women's side, number South Carolina crushed Creighton. Number 1 Stanford beat Texas. Number 1 Louisville took down Michigan. And number 2 UConn upset North Carolina State in what is probably the game of the year. That game went into double overtime, and Paige Becker scored 27 points. Sheesh. On the men's side, number 2 Duke beat Arkansas. And number 8 North Carolina demolished the Cinderella St. Peter's team to set up the classic Duke-UNC rivalry in Coach K's last hurrah as a college basketball coach. Sad to see him go, but it should be a fun matchup there. Number 2 Villanova beat Houston, and number 1 Kansas came back to destroy Miami. Something interesting to note is that there are all blue blood teams in the men's Final Four. That's Duke, UNC, Kansas, and Villanova. Well, on the women's side, it's only number 1 seeds except for UConn in the women's Final Four. So it should be some really intriguing matchups there this weekend. Make sure to watch on ESPN, ESPN2, and TBS. WNBA news. Don't forget the Brittany Griner. She's still stuck in Russia. Don't forget about her, please. Brittany Griner is still stuck in Russia. And on the men's side of things, Paul George returning for the Clippers tonight against the Jazz. Hope to push his team into a playoff seed. And the Clippers should be pretty good with him coming back. Lastly, in sports news, the Seattle Seahawks are in talks with Colin Kaepernick, who hasn't played in the league since 2016 after the big kneeling thing that happened, whole kneeling controversy, and so he might be going back into the NFL.
Wild.
Now, this weekend, Mattie.
The Grammys!
The Grammys!
I love awards show season. I just want to put that out there. My mom hates them, but I love them. Like, she's like, they're so boring, and I'm like, I love them.
I think it's so fun.
I love to watch awards show. Award shows.
Having the Oscars and the Grammys back-to-back weekends, amazing.
What a good time. So, before the show, Zach and I made little Grammys predictions
so, yeah.
for the major awards.
Awards.
Thank you. I lost my words.
Preface this too really quickly. Me, Lydia, and Kenji's Oscar picks from last weekend did not go well.
Oh, no. So we'll see about these Grammy
picks. About these Grammy Awards predictions now. But Grammys, I'm excited for. I think it's a great year of music. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of artists delayed their albums because of COVID until 2021. And now we get to see them rise to the top.
Absolutely. So for Record of the Year, which Zach and I Googled before, means it's about the actual production of a recording.
Yeah, the engineering, the production, the studio creators, all that.
All of that. The nominees are I Still Have Faith in You by ABBA, Freedom by John Batiste, I Get a Kick Out of You by Tony Bennett and Lady Gaga, Peaches by Justin Bieber featuring Daniel Caesar and Givian, Right on Time by Brandi Carlile, Kiss Me More, Doja Cat featuring SZA, Happier Than Ever by Billie Eilish, Montero, Call Me By Your Name by Lil Nas X, Driver's License by Olivia Rodrigo, and Leave the Door Open by Silk Sonic.
I am so intrigued to pick Leave the Door Open or Montero. I'd love her to be Montero, but my heart of hearts, you know, based on the sound and all that. Kiss Me More, I think, is the winner.
It's only a good song.
It's a really good song, and it won the Billboard for Best Song of the Year. So
yeah, I picked Happier Than Ever. I think Billie has a lot of momentum right now. She just won an Oscar Sunday night. I feel like she's getting a lot of love right now, and I feel like it's gonna keep going.
Yeah, she's peaking.
And
right
that
now.
Was a great song. The sound of it was really nice, so I'm gonna say happier than ever.
She's peaking right now for sure. Moving on to Album of the Year, the nominations are We Are by John Batiste, Love for Sale by Tony Bennett and Lady Gaga, Justice by Justin Bieber, Planet Her by Doja Cat, Happier Than Ever by Billie Eilish, Montero by Lil Nas X, Back of My Mind by Her, Sour by Olivia Rodrigo, Evermore by Taylor Swift, and the highly anticipated Donda by Kanye West.
Mm.
What you thinking?
My heart wants Evermore. But just as a Swiftie, my heart wants Evermore. But again, I'm going to pick Happier Than Ever. I think it was a beautifully crafted album. And I love Billie, so.
How could you not? I'm going to go Olivia Rodrigo. I think everyone loves her right now, so I think they'll just have to give it to her.
There's no skips on the album either.
Yeah, it's crazy. Running a little bit of time here, but Song of the Year, me and Mattie are both predicting that Driver's License by Olivia Rodrigo will take home the Grammy for that.
I don't see how it can't. It's so good.
It's so good. I think the lyrics in that are perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And then Best New Artist, a lot of ones I haven't even heard of, but I think Olivia Rodrigo will win it.
I definitely see that happening. Just to be quirky and different, I picked Phineas.
I like that Phineas selection.
I love him, so.
I would love if Kid Laroi won, but I don't think it'll happen.
See, I would love to see Arlo Parks win.
Arlo Parks, that one too. That would be great. I'm surprised Glass Animals is still on here too. This is surprising.
I don't know what they're doing on Best New Artist, but.
It's weird.
Anyway.
Well, have fun watching the Grammys, everybody. Have fun watching March Madness. We will be right back here next week to tell you how our predictions went.
Whoop, whoop.
For your favorite Tuesday traffic jam, I'm Zach Paracha.
And I'm Mattie Freeze.
Have a wonderful, wonderful week. We will see you back here next Tuesday. Have a good night. Something